11th chapter. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here immediately.'" They went away, and they found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" And they told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the one, the kingdom coming of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem, went into the temple, and when he looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated as we hear. Week of his life,
And so we continue to actually understand how the people reacted and responded to him. One of the things that they saw him coming, do you remember what he was riding on? He was riding on a colt, the baby donkey that he was riding in, the young donkey that he was riding on. Kind of seems strange for Jesus to be riding a donkey, doesn't it? Yeah. So one of the things that Jesus does is he follows some of the history of some of the kings of Israel that actually, that's how they actually presented themselves in front of others, is because they were actually supposed to be powerful and a dictator. Were they supposed to do that? Telling everybody what they needed to do, not caring about them? No. Instead, he was actually, the kings of Israel were supposed to be those who were humble and understanding that they were to be in charge of tending and caring for all the people of Israel, that they were supposed to be kings that led, that had power, but actually showed mercy and grace, and were actually willing to actually lower themselves in order to actually make sure that they took care of those who were in their care. And so the people were crying out, and sometimes we say, Hosanna is this praise be to God. That's more of the Alleluia. Hosanna is actually a word that continues to say this. Ready? Save us. Ready? Save us. That seems like a different kind of shout, doesn't it? Then praise God, it's actually save us. What does save us sound like? Help us, definitely. Because they were feeling pressure of what was going on. They had the Roman Empire was occupying that part of Israel, and they were crying out, help us, because they're feeling that way, but they're also needing healing, they were needing relationship, they're wanting to be in connection with God, and they were crying out, help us. This is one of the ways that we do pray to God, is actually saying, help us, or forgive us. Other ones are asking for the things that we need from day to day. The other ways that we do it is praying for other people who need love and care and good health. And so we continue to remember that when the people were gathering, they were actually needing Jesus. They were needing somebody to come in during that time to actually love, care for them, and save them. And Jesus did it in a much different way. Instead of actually sitting on that throne that would have been in the area that King David sat on, instead what he actually did was he was hung on a cross. And he did that for us, to save us from our sins and to be the one who continued to actually bring us life. And what did you say in the good times and the bad times? Who are you from your song? Your song you just sang? In the good times? Child of God. And so that's one of those things that God promises, that in what Jesus has done, he's called you that. He knows that you are a child of God right now. And that's exactly who you are. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you continue to surround us with your love and your care, that you continue to be the one who has saved us and redeemed us. You're the one who we call out to when we need help. Please hear our prayers as you promised to do. Protect these, your little children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up. Good morning. Welcome. Have this great day. We actually have a couple announcements to make just for community-wise. The Lions Breakfast that was supposed to be held this morning has been postponed until next Sunday on the 7th, so April 7th. If you want to go and support them, please do so. Just a couple of things that are coming up this week. We have our Holy Week, actually begins now and continues on. On Thursday, we'll have our Monday-Thursday service at 6:30. During that service, our fifth graders will receive First Communion. And so please come and be a part of that service as well. On Friday, Good Friday, at 6:30 is our service. Please come and be a part of that. We will not be having our Saturday 5 o'clock service this week. due to Holy Week. But then on Sunday, we'll have a 9 o'clock service and an 11 o'clock service for Easter Sunday. So please come and be a part of our time here. Just another little reminders for Thrive and Choice. If you have not designated your Thrive and Choice dollars, please do so. You have until next Sunday to be able to do that. If you wish to designate them to St. John or any other nonprofits, you can do that. So, and then also, if you want to continue to support the local food bank, make sure you continue to do that. During our Sunday service last week, we had a noisy offering. During our Wednesday evening service, we did all the offering was going to the food bank. So continue to figure out ways to support and be able to have those things. During our service, we have modified it just a little bit. Actually, we took out the Kyrie and the hymn of praise because our Passion Gospel is a little bit longer. And so we wanted to make sure we had some time for the Sunday school to have their time afterwards as well. And also the last song Diane's going to be playing through at one time just to get the melody. It's a kind of very grounded, old sounding hymn as far as just a very positive way to enter into our week, but also one of those things where it's easy to catch on to the melody. At this time, I invite you to please stand as you're able as we begin our service with a brief order of confession and forgiveness of sins, which is found in 116. We gather this day in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may live according to your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called for a good name, minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now continue with our prayer of the day, which is found printed in our bulletin insert. Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with our first reading. Our first reading for this day comes from Isaiah, the 50th chapter. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning, he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? All of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. This is the word of the Lord. Please join reading responsibly Psalm 31, which is, I'll be reading in light print if you follow with the bold. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
My life is
I am the scorn of my enemies, a disgrace to my neighbors, a dismay to my acquaintances. When I see, they see me in the streets, they avoid me. For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies, from those who persecute me. Our second reading for this day comes from Philippians, the second chapter. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. I invite you to please stand at this time. We'll be singing the gospel acclamation, but I will let you sit following. Oh.
Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world,
what she has done will be told in remembrance of her. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him.
On the first day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he said to two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room? Where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out, went to the city, and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal.
When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." Then they began to be distressed and say to him, one after another, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12 who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, saying, "Take this, is my body." Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
And Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even though all become deserters, I will not." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. But he said vehemently, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to the disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me yet. Not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. And the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd of swords and clubs from the chief priests and scribes and elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who was near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Jesus said to them, "Have you come out here with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him saying, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'" But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do you still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him.
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl on seeing him began to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly, you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse and swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And he broke down and wept.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and the scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. And Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so Pilate was amazed. Now the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison, and the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came before again and asked Pilate, "You do for them according to his custom." Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priest handed him over. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd and they had him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him." Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas before them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat on him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to be crucified. They compelled a passerby who was coming from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon a Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. They crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. At 9 o'clock in the morning, when they crucified him, the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left.
Those who passed by denied him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to bottom. Now when the centurion, who had stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James, the younger, and of Joses, and Salome. These used to follow him and provide for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead and summoned the centurion. He asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth and, taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. First, I want to start off, and I usually don't get very political, But when politics and church start mixing just a little bit, to where the extent that we use terms that we shouldn't apply to some people, it's good to speak about it. The last couple of weeks, I've been seeing some pop-ups of some memes on Facebook and some language that was used, and the language that was used was talking about somebody who was crucified, or somebody being crucified. And another one of glory and talking about how the other one is being lifted up, and there's this really this sinister understanding of what's really going on below it. Those words are ones that continue to actually try to take over something that cannot ever be happened. That within, especially our election coming up for the presidency, neither one of the people who are running are Christ. They're not. They're not being killed, or they're not suffering for the sake of the whole world or even the country. But when that language gets pulled in, sometimes it's used, and especially around this time of Easter and coming into this Holy Week, that's where we speak and say, no. But what is going on around the use of that language, ironically, actually pulls us right back into our gospel for this day. Our gospel for this day, where the people were gathered around. They were actually having hope for somebody to come in to Israel, to actually be the one who would sit on the King David's throne. The one who would actually be the one who actually did the power and majesty of coming in and casting out and pushing away the Romans who were occupying that area. Last night I had an opportunity, and we have some wonderful young theologians within our congregation, and one of them came up to me before the service, and she sat down with me. She always has a question for me. She has a question that sometimes is much higher than sometimes I'm thinking at the point in time, but it draws us into actually understanding how do we think about God. And it's really ironic, too, is how many of you have read the scripture passage before coming to church today? Well, she did. And it's one of those things, it's not a judgment, but one of those things that this was a question that was on her mind, and her question came from actually doing something as silly as reading the scripture. And she's sitting in there, and she goes, okay, and she's kind of bouncing around a little bit. She followed me around until I could get the time to sit with her, and we sat down here at the on the stairs, and she goes, okay, here's my question. So how in the beginning were they sitting there praising God and praising Jesus, and at the end of the week he ends up on the cross? The same people who were praising Jesus at the beginning of the week, at the end of the week were saying, crucify him. Great question. Keep asking them if you have them, because those are the great ones. And it comes in, so we sat down and we talked about what really was going on. We talked about how the change of actually what we sometimes think of Alleluia is what they were saying when they saw Jesus coming and sitting on this donkey, this one that was pointing to understanding this one who is in the kingly order was coming into Jerusalem. And instead of saying Alleluia, they were saying Hosanna. Save us. Lord, save us, is what Hosanna means. And so they were the ones who had been going under the occupation of the Roman Empire, having been there. They knew the promise that was given to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. They knew the promise that was continued on through King David. And they're sitting there going, why are we still occupied? Why are we still having health issues? Why are we still having troubles within our society, economically or socially, or even within our families? What's going on? And so they see Jesus as the one who is coming in to do one thing, and that's to save them. Save them. And so coming in to save them, they think that he's going to do one thing. He's here. He's on this donkey. He's going to Jerusalem, and we're going down and we're lifting up this, Lord, save us, as we're going around. And as they get into the city of Jerusalem, they get even get up to the temple, Jesus does something that probably starts them going, how are you saving us by doing this action? See, when Jesus got in, he came in, he actually went, and he went to the temple, he actually probably prayed, like Grace said last night, and then he went home. He went out and left the city. That is not what somebody who is coming in to establish a kingly presence does. But that's not who Jesus is. And that's not how Jesus has brought his salvation to us. Jesus comes not to be the one who comes and sits on the throne and respects power to be an homage to be given to him, but indeed one who ends up taking the cross for us. The one who comes in and actually does the unbelievable. The one who is actually the one who dies and raised so we can actually be those sons and daughters, those children of God. When we're good and when we're bad, he continues to hold on to those promises that he is our God and this is what he's done. So how does this relate to the election stuff that we're talking about? Just like them, today we are still sitting there going, okay, why are we still sick? Why is my memory not being as sharp as it should be? Why are my lungs not able to breathe like they should? Why is cancer continuing to be something that hits home with many people? Why are our relationships struggling? And I think much like what the people of Israel are sitting there, I think those sometimes are on our words. Our words that continue to go out, God save us. Save us. And we fail to understand where God has come and actually dwelt and gave his promises. God uses those who continue to lead and continue to care for the people, to actually support and to care for the well-being of one another. But that's not what saves. What's as saved is Jesus coming in and doing what God has accomplished on that cross and in his resurrection. For us to actually be those who hold on to that with hope and trusting in his word. Not turning to an earthly king or an earthly leader for hope, but actually clinging to the promise that we have in life and in death that we are his. That we continue to hear these words and that we continue to come to him and trust that he is bringing us a salvation. Trust that he is caring for us in the midst of our struggles. Trust in him in the midst of a time when we need healing and wellness, both physically, mentally, and socially, that we continue to hear and trust that this one has indeed come to save you and me. This Christ who has took the cross and has risen from the dead continues to give you the hope and trust to come to him anytime you need, to lift up those prayers of save us, forgive us, hear us. May we continue to go out into a world that is asking that question or wanting that response and tell them what is coming, who the words are, and where we find God within his word, to be able to trust and believe in a time that is not filled with glory, but filled with sometimes suffering, because he continues to be the one who has given us victory over sin, death, and the grave. For us to be able to hold on and hope of what is yet to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now join together in singing our hymn of this day. Our hymn of this day is Believe in the Cross of Jesus, 338.
Thank you.
one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, was suffered death, and was dead. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us now continue with the prayers of the people. Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and the whole world. Blessed One, today the church sings with glad hosannas as we enter the Holy Week. Prepare to us for us to bear witness to Christ's suffering and death endured for our sake. Gather your people around the cross and comfort us with resurrection hope. Lord, in your mercy, renew your good creation and protect the balance of life. Continue to watch over those who continue to care and tend, the farmers, the ranchers, those who continue to invite us into the stewardship as well. Lord, in your mercy, bring hope to any who feel forsaken and forgotten. Make a way for refugees and asylum seekers. Unite those who have been separated. We pray for with any who are incarcerated or institutionalized or in foster care, that they may know your love. We ask that you continue to be with those that we lift up this day. Maddie, Trevor, Charlene, Washa, Eric, Brown, Power, Kathy Deerhog, Vicki Horsch, Gail Emerson, Kendra Gibbs, Renee Brown, Bill Gibbs, Shirley Engstrom, Peggy Iverson, Paul Sversky, Colleen Prayo, Kathy Wellington, Dave Wingy, Lynn Denzer, Rick Hanslick, Darlene Omber, Kathy Janowski, Lori Helling, Peggy Svoboda, Hillary Birdsell, Doris Henderson, Berlin Tai, Lisa Prochak, Cindy Drzinski, Dennis Krautkramer, Jill Myers, Joyce Danzer, Pam Krieger, Eric Kingstrom, Zeke Jarecka, Matthew Bowen, Harvey Chapman, Preston Pollington, Michael Pollington, Aubrey Grover, Cindy Lighthizer, Milo Kavinsky, Lloyd Svoboda, Adeline Teedy, Eric Nish, Ken Meyer, Diane Levine Schultz, Tom Trinda, Amy Porthus, Yvonne Porthus, and Joy Porthus. Be with those who are serving our country. We lift up to you Noah Bachman, Brett Byrne, Lane Chapman, Jack Chapman, Travis Ferguson, Cassie Gilbertson, David Cortes, Ashley Noisky, Michael Schock, Alex Schock, Brennan Mountcount, and Sam Westerhouse. Be with them and their families as they serve, and with those that we lift up to you now, through the silent prayer of love. Lord, in your mercy, give energy and joy to our pastors and deacons, worship leaders and musicians. Bless those who are coming forward for baptism, their sponsors, those who continue to study and learn confirmation, the teachers who are guiding them. Watch over all who travel this week. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed One, our times are in your hands. Sustain us within discipleship through our lives and receive into everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Accompany us on our journey, Heavenly Father, and receive our prayers and the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Let us now receive an offering for the care and concern of the ministries of this congregation, for this community which are a part of the world to which we've been sent. Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and may we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Hear, trust, and believe that this promise is indeed for you. This gift is open to all Christians who believe in them to come and receive. Thank you. God of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift his favor upon you and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let's join together in singing our ascending song. Our ascending song is inserted within our bulletin. Peace of Christ be with you always.